Separation of variables really only applies to first order differential equations. Only first order, so only first derivatives. And so we're gonna start on with that. Now, the other thing I'm gonna tell you in this section and in the other sections of the class when we have a different technique, I'm going to start each section off with giving you on the board an overview of the technique. You kind of have to do that because if I just dove right into a problem, then you wouldn't really, you might get it, but it's just, I think it's a lot more instructive for me to list everything what we're going to do kind of in general. And then when we do the problems, we're going to do that method so many times that you'll just basically memorize it without trying. So let's get right into it. It's called separation of variables. Okay, and so separation of variables. And you're gonna see in a second that the reason it's called separation of variables is because literally we take the differential equation, we split the variables apart. But it turns out you can only do that in certain cases when the differential equation is of a certain form. Okay, so here we go. If you have a first order, and I'm going to underline it because it only applies to first order equations. A first order ordinary differential equation, ODE, of the form, dot, dot, I'm gonna put the form here in a different color. The form of the differential equation is, let's just say it's dx dt is equal to some function of x and some function of t. Now, I really want you to look at this and you know, I could just go on, but I really want to kind of break down the barriers with you and make you realize that it's not so hard to understand. We haven't even gotten to the solution method yet. But a lot of times in your book, you're going to see this kind of thing where you have an equation written like this, and a lot of students look at it, they don't really see a typical equation, polynomial, or anything, so their brain shuts down a little bit. F of x, g of t, what does all that mean? You need to really not gloss over that stuff. Try to understand what your book is telling you, and I'm going to help you along the way here. What this is saying is your differential equation has to have a derivative with respect to something. I mean, this could be dy, dx, could be dz with respect to, you know, epsilon. It could be any variable, but you're generally going to use x and t. So derivative of x with respect to time, and that is on one side of the equal sign. This derivative is all by itself over here. And on the other side of the equal sign, you have a function of x, that's what f of x means, and a function of t. So this f of x could be, you know, we could have dx, dt, it could equal to x squared times time. This is a function of x, this is a function of t. Our differential equation could be, you know, dx, dt is equal to t to the 1/2 times the square root of x. So you see, here we have a function of t, and here we have a function of x. Now these are multiplied together, so it doesn't matter if you have a function of t or a function of x, you know, flipped around, but you definitely have to have a function of x multiplied by a function of t. It isn't the same thing as saying, you know, dx with respect to time. You can't say square root of x to the t power. That's not going to work. This is not of this form as illustrated on the board. I mean, here you sort of have a function of x and you sort of have some time involved, but it's not, those are wrapped up together. You don't have a situation here where they're multiplied together. So in order for this solution method to work, it has to look exactly like the form. That's probably the number one thing you have to know. We're going to get into variation parameters and other solution methods, and you're going to have to make sure that the equation you're trying to use it for is exactly of the right form. So dx dt equal to some function of x, whatever it is, could be a giant polynomial in x, multiplied by some function of t, doesn't matter what it is, could be, you know, cosine of t. But it has to be a function of x and a function of t, and they have to be multiplied together. Now, if it's not of this form, if you can take your differential equation and beat it into this form, then you can also apply this solution method. So just to give you one quick example before we go on, let's say you had t squared times dx dt is equal to x. Now this does not look like it's of the right form, but it actually is, because if I take, and this is just an equation, if I divide by t squared, I would have dx dt is equal to, and I can write it as x times 1 over t squared if I divide both sides by this. So you see I have a function of x and a function of t. And so the little magical, it's really not magical, but the technique that we're going to learn here is able to be used if your equation is already in this form, or if you can just do simple manipulations to put it in this form. I just wanted to make sure you understand that before you go too far. All right, so basically we have the differential equation presented to you, and it's of this form here. All right, and what we're going to do next is we're going to rewrite it. We're going to rewrite it, this differential equation, as follows. We're going to go ahead and multiply by dt. So we're going to have dx is equal to this function of x times this function of t, and we're going to have dt here. So dt, we're just going to basically treat this like a fraction, and we're going to multiply this side by dt, leaving only dx, and we're going to bring it over here. So basically that's the only difference between those two steps. Now once we have it in this form, if we continue on, if we take this function of x and move it over here, then what you would have is 1 over f of x dx on the left hand side is equal to g of t, this function of time, times dt. So you see we've separated the variables at that point. That's really all, that's all it's talking about. When you talk about separation of variables, you have a derivative, and on the right hand side you have a function of x and a function of t, and they're multiplied together. All you're doing is splitting up the differential, splitting up the derivative, and moving one of the dt's over here and keeping the dx on the other side. And then whatever that function of x is, you go ahead and divide both sides by it so that you get on the left-hand side of the equation some function of x. I mean, yeah, it's 1 over, but this is still some function of x times dx. And on the right-hand side, all you have is some function of t times dt. So you see, you have separated the variables. And it's only possible for you to actually separate them if they're multiplied together like this, some function of x, some function of time. If they're wrapped up together, like if you had cosine of x times t or something, there's no way you can separate that those variables because they're wrapped up inside of a cosine. If you had, like the other example, square root of x raised to the power of t, there's no way you can do this because there's no way you're going to be able to separate x and t. It's all wrapped up inside of a square root in that case. But if you have a function multiplied by a function, then you can divide everything and separate everything neatly, and that's why it has to be of this form. Okay, so we have a function of x times dx, a function of t times gt, and I bet you that you can guess what we're going to do next is we're going to integrate both sides. So we'll integrate both sides. So we'll integrate both sides, and so what we're going to do is just slap an integral sign, 1 over f of x dx is equal to g of t dt. And we have an integral on both sides. And so basically at this point, this is going to be some function that you'll either know how to integrate or you won't, but hopefully you'll have a trick, you know, or some kind of substitution or something that you'll be able to integrate this side, and you'll get a function of x over here. And over here, you're going to integrate this with respect to t, and you're going to get a function of t over here. So in the end, you're going to have a function of x over here is equal to a function of t over here. And at that point, all you have to do is solve for x. Because remember, the whole point of a differential equation is to find x of t, the function of x that satisfies the original differential equation that you had is what you're trying to find. X is always going to be a function of time. So what you're going to have in the end of the day is you're going to obtain something like this. Capital F, I'm going to call it, of x is equal to capital G of t plus a constant. Now let me explain this. All this is saying a lot of times in calculus and also in differential equations is when you have a little function here, we're calling it f of x, or let's look at this one, g of t is a little lowercase g. When we integrate it, a lot of times books will use a capital letter to denote the function that we got after we did the integration. So this is nothing more than what I already told you. You're going to integrate this and get some function of x. We're calling it capital F. Just to differentiate from, I mean, if we called it f of x again, then you would be confused because is it this one in here or what? So we use a capital to tell you that this is what we get after we integrate. And on the other side, it's the same thing. We have g of t, we integrate it, and then we don't want to put little g here because then we'll get confused. So we just call it capital G. But the bottom line is, don't worry so much about the variables. You get a function of x over here and you get a function of t over here, and we have our integration constant. Now, you might ask, do we have an integration constant on this side and on this side? Well, yeah, the answer is yes. You would have an integration constant over here, we call it C, and you have an integration constant over here, you call it C. But at the end of the day, you'll be able to add these constants together. If this was, you know, plus 5 and this was plus 3, you could just subtract and basically move the constant over to one side. So in general, you're just going to put one constant of integration. And really, it's sort of the sum of the two that you have there, or the difference, or however you want to look at it, because you can just sort of move it over to the other side. So instead of showing all that, you know, in books, you'll just see it written with a constant on one side. Okay, so the next thing you're going to do after you obtain this guy, because this is a function of x, you'll try to solve for x in terms of t. In terms of t, which is really what you're trying to find anyway. Okay, so this is the method of separation of variables. Let me put a few, you know, a few little numbers here. So let's call it step one. Let's call this step two. And then what we're going to do is we're going to call this step three. The integration we'll call step four, you know, and then we'll call this step five. After we do the integration, we'll call this step six to solve for that. So basically, this is what you have here. Just to kind of recap it, it's called separation of variables because you have a derivative with respect to whatever variable you have. And on the other side is a function of this variable and a function of the other variable, and they're multiplied together. So that's step one, verify that you have the correct form. Step two is go ahead and try to manipulate it just like an equation to get, in the end of the day, you want to do integration. So you want to have a function of x on one side and a function of t on the other. So we begin by moving dt over to one side, and then the next step we move f of x over to the other side by division, just like a regular equation. So you have 1 over f of x dx, g of t dt. So you have a function of x and a function of t just like you wanted on both sides. The next step is to go ahead and try to integrate there. And so there's a huge, you know, gap here between 4 and 5 because then you have to do the integration, and that's just basic calculus at that point. And then it may be really advanced calculus depending on the integrals that you have in here. So then you do the integration and you're going to end up with a function of x on the left hand side and a function of t on the right plus your integration constant. And then this could be a polynomial, this could be who knows what it is, it depends on what your function is. So the final step is to try to manipulate the equation to solve for x. When you get x of t, that is the answer, all right? That's the what you would call the general solution, right, of this differential equation. Now, if you had initial conditions on top of that telling you how, you know, how the problem started out at time is equal to zero or something, then you would do exactly what we did in the last section, and you would apply those initial conditions and try to find the specific solution. So here, when you get to the end of step six, it's the general solution. Now, a couple things. It does only work for first order, because for first order equations are really the only ones that are going to lend itself to kind of breaking up this differential like that. And being able to separate it. And it only works for this form right here. So it's kind of limited in that sense. But on the other hand, lots of actual functions in nature and things that really we study in science really are first order differential equations. I mean, lots of them are. So separation of variables should be one of the first things you look for, because a lot of times it actually does work. So what we're going to do is solve a problem. And I think it... hopefully you're able to follow this, okay? I really did try to make it where you can, but if you don't, when we get to a problem, it'll be very, very clear what we're doing, because it's just going to make it a lot easier to understand the steps. So let's say we're going to solve the following differential equation. 3 times dx dt is equal to 2x. All right? So what we're going to do first is say you're on a test here, and your objective is to solve this thing, and you're looking through your techniques, and you want to find out first, the first thing you should check is see, is it separable? Well, the question that you need to answer is it of the form dx dt is equal to a function of x times a function of time? Is this true? And it doesn't look like it at first, but the answer is yes, it is true, because if I were to take and divide this equation by 3, then I would have dx dt on the left, just like this, and on the right, I would have 2/3 x. And that certainly is a function of x, and the function of time, you know, is nothing there, so that's fine too. So it's a function of x and it's a function of t, because even though there is no t over there, you know, that's a perfectly valid function of time too, you know, just a constant like that. So that's perfectly valid, and you do follow that form. So you're good to go so far. And so the next step is to try to bust up basically all the elements here to get your functions all on one side. You know, function of x on one side, function of t on the other side. So what we're going to do first is multiply by dt. So we'll have 3 dx on the left is equal to 2x dt. So all we did is take this little dt differential and move it over to the other side by multiplication. That's all we did. Everything stays exactly the same. And remember, ultimately, you want a function of x over here so you can integrate, and you want a pure function of t on this side. So we're going to move 2x over this way. And when we do that, we're going to have 3 over 2x dx on this side of the equation is equal to dt on the other. Now, this is exactly where we want to be, because we have dx and we have a function of x, and we have dt and we do have a function of t. Now, it just so happens to be the number 1, right? But that is a function of time. If it's a constant, that's still a good function of time, right? So that's totally fine. And notice that it does follow exactly what we have over here. We have obtain some function of x times dx is equal to some function of time times dt. Now, this can look really confusing in a textbook, but when you look at this, you shouldn't be intimidated by that. We can handle that. All right, so the next thing we're going to do, right? The next thing we're going to do is integrate. So we're going to put a little integral sign there. We'll have 3 divided by 2x. And we'll have dx, and we'll have integral of dt on this side. Now, just to make it a little bit more clear, instead of writing it like that, I'm going to write it like this, 1 over x. So it's the same thing, 3/2 times 1 over x. That's all I did, just to make it a little bit clearer for our integration step next. Now, you all know from integrals that the constant comes out of the integral, so we'll have 3/2 come right on out, and the integral of what we have left, the 1 over x, you should know, is the natural log of the absolute value of x, right? And then on the right-hand side, what's the integral of dt? That's very simply t. And then let's go ahead and put our constant of integration over here. Now, a question I get a lot is, well, what happened to the constant of integration that's over here? I mean, you always should have a constant anytime you integrate. Absolutely true. So we actually do have a constant. Well, let's just put it here for a second. Let's see what happens. So let's say we did add a constant over here, and we have another constant over here. Well, this constant could be anything. It could be 10. I mean, that's the whole point of a constant of integration. It can be absolutely anything. So 10 or 15 or 20 or whatever. Here's a totally separate constant of integration. Well, in the very next step in this problem, I could simply move this constant over here to be combined with the one that's sitting here, and thereby making a new constant. That new constant is the one that I really care about in the end, and so that's why there's no bother to really write that. So I can just sort of take that right out. This is the only constant that's really going to be relevant in the problem. One more thing I'll tell you is, remember, this is a first order differential equation. The number of constants of integration, or the number of constants that you get in the answer to the solution, remember we talked about that, is going to be equal to the order of your equation. So it's first order. We should have only one constant in the final answer. And only one initial condition is going to be needed to find the value of this constant that we're going to get later, you know, to find the specific solution. So we'll take it one step at a time. So here you see we've arrived at the point where we've done the integration. We have a function of x here. We have a function of t. So at this point, we are down here. Because we've done the integration, we do have a function of x. We do have a function of t, and we do have a constant, but, you know, you got to finish the job, right? So in order to get the answer, we want to solve for x. You know, we want to solve for x. So the first thing is, let's get rid of this 3/2 because it just bothers me. We want to isolate the natural log by itself. So let's put the natural log there, and we'll make this 2/3 t plus a constant. Now, again, you might get the question, how did you do that? Well, we multiplied by 2/3, that canceled on this side. Over here, we have the 2/3 because we multiplied, and the constant was also multiplied by 2/3, but It's just a constant. Multiply by 2/3 just yields a constant. So in the end, this C is representing whatever constant falls out in the end. So multiplying it, it's just like in the step before when we had, you know, in our heads, we added this other constant to it. In the end, you're only going to have one constant in your answer. So whatever you do to it, multiplying it, dividing it, subtracting, adding to it, doesn't matter. In the end, it's just one constant, you know, in the end of the day. So how do you solve this equation for x? The only way to take an x out of a natural log that way is to raise the whole darn thing to the power of e. And if you do it to one side, you're going to have to do it to the other side. So you have 2/3 t plus a constant. All of this stuff is in the exponent of e like that. All right. Now, when you raise it like this, e raised to the natural log of x is going to return x, so that's what you wanted to do. And on the right-hand side, you're going to have e raised to the power of 2/3 times time, right? And one more thing I want to show you is, this is really somewhat simplified, but I want to write it a little bit differently. I'm going to write it as multiplied by e to the power of c. And you might wonder, why is Jason doing this? There's a very good reason, you'll see in just a second. But first, for now, just make sure you find that it's legal. I mean, remember, anytime you have two things raised to a power with the same base, you just add the exponents. I mean, it's the same thing as, you know, x squared times x, you know, to the third. What is this? Well, this is x to the fifth. Because x is the same, you just add the exponents, right? We're not really doing anything differently here in this case. So if you look, these two steps, you should be able to convince yourself are totally equivalent. Here, we've added the exponents. Here, we just break it up a little bit. And the reason that I'm doing that is because the final answer that I want is going to be x, as a function of time, don't forget, is equal to e raised to the 2/3 time. Actually, what I want to do is back up a little bit and say x of time is equal to, this is, comes from here, and then this guy, e raised to this constant, is just going to yield, you know, a constant. So we're going to put big fat C right in front, and this is going to be the answer. This is the general solution. Of this differential equation. It's some constant raised, times E raised to the power of 2/3 times time. That is the answer. Now, notice, it's a first order differential equation, so our answer only has one constant. That's totally perfect. Now, if we had an initial condition that told us, you know, what x was doing at time is equal to zero, then we could plug that in and find this constant, whatever it is for that initial condition, and then we would have the specific solution of our specific differential equation. So let's go back to the top and just take it from the top. We have a simple differential equation. We just simply brought the differential over and tried to pull x and get a function of x in front of dx and a function of t in front of dt, and we integrate both sides. This became a natural log. And this is just a simple integration here. And then we move the constant over to the other side. And to get x by itself, we had to raise both sides to the power of e. This isolates x for us. It kind of complicates the right-hand side a little bit, but you need to realize that this exponent here can be broken up. And then this just becomes our constant of integration. So you need to get into the habit of realizing that whenever you have a constant of integration, if you multiply it or divide it or square root it or whatever you do after it becomes a constant of integration, you can just keep writing it as C, or keep writing it as just your new constant that just looks a little bit different from before, because in the end, the final constant that you have is really the one that you care about. So getting in all these intermediate steps to the answer doesn't really matter. You started with a constant here, doesn't matter what you do to it, beat it, you know, beat on it with a hammer, but when you get to the end of it, that is what you need to write as your constant C, because you need to have one constant for every order, or for whatever order or differential equation that you have. Okay, this is a good problem. This is a good little introductory problem, because it's, you know, the integrals are not hard. You don't have to do any integration by parts or anything. And I think most people can get that. Now let's go to another one. It's not hard, but it is a little bit more involved. So let's go and say the next problem is going to be e to the power of 2t times first derivative of x plus e raised to the power of t is equal to 1. And so that's your differential equation. Now, I really don't like, books do this a lot, so that's why I do it, but I like writing my differential equations, at least for now, like this, dx dt. This is what this x prime means. Plus e to the t is equal to 1. That's what really what you're dealing with. And the reason it's important for separation of variables is because you're gonna end up splitting that up. So the first thing you need to look at when you see a differential equation is to ask yourself, is it separable? Well, even me, when I look at this at first, I'm not sure if it's separable or not. I really don't know. A lot of times you have to play with it. You know, you have to massage it a little bit, just like an integral. You might have to change an integral a little bit in order to be able to solve it. Same thing here. Play with this a little bit and see if you can get it into the form of separable equations. So let's see if we can. So the first thing we're going to do is basically just take this e to the t and let's move it over to the other side. So we'll have e to the power of 2t times dx dt. Now let's just say 1 minus e to the t. We just take this and move it over. Let's see what we have. All right, and then let's move this over here. So we'll have dx dt is equal to 1 minus e to the power of t over e to the 2t. Now look at that. Now we do have a separable equation. And the reason you know it's separable is because remember, separable means dx dt is equal to some function of x times some function of t. And so we do have dx dt. This is all a function of t, so we have this part. Function of x just happens to be 1. So that is totally of the right form. So let's go ahead and fix this. Let's move dt over here. So we'll have dx on the left-hand side, and on the right we'll have 1 minus e to the power of t over e to the 2t, and we'll be multiplying and getting dt over here. And so now we're really in good shape to be able to integrate this guy. We're in very good shape to be able to integrate this guy. So, draw a little arrow here, and we'll just rewrite the problem. We'll put an integral on both sides. Integral dx is equal to integral 1 minus e to the t over e to the 2t dt. So you see, nice function of x we can integrate, nice function of t we can integrate over dt. So this is kind of ugly, you know, it's a little bit ugly, but you have to have your skills from calculus in order to be able to get anywhere in differential equations. So, you know, you might start thinking about substitutions of things, but really the first thing I see when I see a numerator that has more than one term like this and a denominator that's only one term, my first instinct is to break it up into two terms because a lot of times it'll be simpler. So that's what I'm going to do. And so let's take on the left, it's going to be pretty simple. You have an x on the left. And on the right, what you're going to have, this guy, you're going to have integral. And let's just go ahead and split it up. We'll have 1 over e to the 2t minus e to the t over e to the 2t dt. Now, I do want to write this a little bit more clearly, but I think you get the idea. So what I want to do, x is equal to integral, try to write it a little bit bigger, 1 over e to the 2t minus e to the t over e to the 2t dt, just to make it clear. Now, what we've done here, look at this. This is just a simple fraction. Common denominator is the same. So you can just, you know, simply subtract the top and you would get back what you have right over there. So it's totally legal to do that. And the nice thing about it is now you have one integral to deal with and then you have another integral to deal with. So it makes it a little bit easier anyway. Now, one thing I want to rewrite it as, x is going to be equal to 1 over e to the 2t is just going to be e to the negative 2t. That's a lot easier to work with in terms of an integral. And then over here, because you have t on the top and 2t on the bottom, this is just going to be e to the minus t dt, because you subtract. When you have a numerator or denominator, t minus 2t gives me negative t. Now this, ladies and gentlemen, you see, this looks a whole lot simpler. When I look at this, I'm like, oh my goodness, what do I do? When I look at this, I'm like, okay, that's not too bad. I've got this little piece and I've got this little piece, and I know how to do both of those. So I can definitely proceed to the answer. So What we're going to do, now a lot of you guys have been doing integrals for a long time up through calculus, so you look at this and you might know exactly what the integrals are by staring at them. Even to this day, if there is a very simple substitution that needs to happen, I do the substitution by writing it all out. And I'm not doing this just because I'm teaching a class, I'm doing this because it helps me keep it straight. But I know a lot of you guys could stare at this and just put the integral down on paper, that's fine. But for everybody else, including me, I like to write it out, so bear with me a little bit. For this integral, right here, I want to say that u substitution is equal to negative 2t because I want to write this as e to the u because I know how to take an integral of e to the u. So du is equal to negative 2dt, right? And that's just from your regular calculus. And so then dt is equal to negative 1/2 du. Dt is negative 1/2 du. And so when I substitute it in there, what I'm going to have is an integral of e to the u, because u is equal to this, so it's e to the u times whatever dt is, which I just solved for. So it's going to be 1/2 du. This is a super simple integral we'll be able to solve in the next step. All right, that's what this one's equal to. Now this guy over here, trying to give a little bit of distance here, this guy over here is almost exactly the same thing, except u is going to equal to negative t, and du is equal to negative 1 times dt, because I'm just taking the derivative of both sides, and so dt is equal to negative du. Dt is equal to negative du. And so when I plug that back into the integral, I'm going to have over here, we'll get to this negative sign a little bit later, but the integral itself is going to be integral of e to the u times negative du, times negative du. Now these are very simple integrals to solve, which is nice. These are very simple integrals to solve. So what we're going to have here is, let's go ahead and rewrite it. So what we're going to have on the next board, we'll just put those down again. So what we'll have is x is going to be equal to, we'll say x of t is going to be equal to the integral of e to the u times negative 1/2 du, okay? And then what we're going to have for the other integral is we're going to have a minus sign because of an integral between them, and we'll have a integral of e to the u times negative 1 du, okay? This is exactly from the previous board. I haven't actually done anything. If you look back where we were, we have the integral of this, which is e to the u, negative 1/2 du. Integral over here is e to the u, integral e to the u times negative du. There is a minus sign between these two integrals, so I made sure to carry that minus sign right between them. But the integrals themselves are exactly the same. I just put the minus sign right in between. So x of t is equal to, now it's very simple, because negative 1/2 comes out, negative 1/2. E to the u, integral of that is just simply e to the u, right? Now this minus sign also comes out, which is going to make a plus. Integral of e to the u is e to the u. And then we have plus a constant. Now the only thing you have to be careful about when you do this kind of thing is you got to make sure your u's are right. In the first integral, u was negative 2t. In the second integral, u was equal to negative t. So you got to make sure and get that straight. So x of t is negative 1/2 e minus 2t plus e, and over here we said it was equal to negative t plus a constant. 1/2 e to the minus 2t plus e to the minus t plus a constant. And this is the answer. This is the general solution. This is the general solution. So basically, you know, there are a few steps here, but the integrals, you know, even though it was kind of long, the integrals really weren't that hard. I mean, basically you started with something like this, you converted it over to differential notation because it's easier to work with separation of variables. You beat it into shape a little bit by, you know, subtracting something over here, dividing, and you realize that you did have a derivative and you did have a pure function of t on the other side, so it did fit the form. Then you simply moved your dt over and integrated both sides. This integral looks a little bit ugly, but then you realize, okay, you can split it up into two integrals. If you know of another technique to do this, fine, do it. That's okay. I'm just, you know, doing the technique that I'm comfortable with. So I split them up, and you have e to the negative 2t here, e to the negative t here, and at this point in your paper, you would just solve both of those integrals separately, subtract them, and then boom, you have the answer. So we do a quick substitution. U is equal to negative 2t, take the derivative, and then we put it back into the form, e to the u times what we found here for dt, and then we do exactly the same thing over here, e to the u times what we found for dt once we did this stuff, solving both of those integrals and plugging back in for what we substituted for u, basically yields this. So we have the two integrals subtracted together, we do the integration, which is simple because it's an exponential, we plug in for negative 2t for the first integral and for negative t for the second, because those were our substitutions, and we have one constant. Again, only one constant of integration, and that's because our differential equation is first order, so we're always going to have one constant. So you see, it's a methodical process. It's just that, just like all of differential equations, there's a ton of opportunity to screw up. So you really need to check every little step of the way and make sure that you're getting the right answers and checking everything as you go. So I'm going to erase the board. We'll do a couple more just to kind of get your feet wet with exactly the method here, and we'll get more comfortable by working more problems. All right, now the next problem is, looks a little bit more complicated, but you'll see it's not that big of a deal. X plus 1 times t squared plus 1 is equal to t times dx dt. All right, so what you have here is a sort of a complicated looking equation, and so obviously you're going to do it by separation of variables, but on your test you wouldn't know that. That's the real trick with differential equations. It's so frustrating when you sit in your test and you're looking at an equation and you have no idea. You have a dozen different techniques. Which one is it? Well, you need to get some practice with that. The big clue here is that you have these two terms multiplied together. I mean, that should be a dead giveaway that you should at least really look hard at separation of variables. Because you see, we're doing all this dividing of terms to get everything on the one side that you want. If you have nice terms that are nicely multiplied like this, chances are that you'll be able to move them into the right place. So let's go ahead and try to do that. Of course, you know that you will be able to in this course, but on your test, you won't know. So dx dt, we're going to leave this over here. We're going to divide by t, and so we're going to make this on top, x plus 1 times t squared plus 1 divided by t. Just divided by t, that's all we did. And you can see that this is totally valid. So dx dt, the form that we're looking for is f of x, so some function of x times some function of time. And you can see that here you have a function of x, and the function of time is, the t squared plus 1 divided by t. So, that's totally a valid way to write this, because when you think about it, you can write this as x plus 1 multiplied by t squared plus 1 over t. If you multiply these two things together, you're going to get that. It's just a simple, fraction multiplication. T times 1 gives you t, and this times this gives you this. So this is the function of x, and this is the function of t. It's all nicely separable. And by the way, you do call it separable differential equation when you're able to do that. All right, so next thing we want to do is try to manipulate everything and get it on one side. So what we'll do is just to kind of, I don't want to say we're skipping steps, but in your mind, visualize, we're going to divide by x plus 1. So what we're going to end up having is 1 over x plus 1 times dx. And on the right-hand side, we're going to end up with t squared, let's put an equal sign, plus 1 divided by t times dt. Now make sure you understand this. Basically, you multiply by dt, so that's sitting out here. So that's what the t squared plus 1 and the t are from. And then at the same time, we divide by x plus 1, moving it over here. So that's why we have 1 over like that. So you're in the right place. You've got a function of x, dx, a function of t, dt. So the next step is integration. So we will integrate 1 over x plus 1 dx, and we will integrate t squared plus 1 over t dt. And so that's exactly where we want to be. Now here you have two integrals. What do? Well, you solve them, obviously, right? So you got to know what to do there, and that's just your calculus skills, unfortunately. So, or fortunately, depending on how good you are at that. So for this integral, and by the way, I do this on my paper. I put these little curly braces and I work on this integral, and then I do little curly braces and I work on this integral, and at the end, you kind of combine everything together. That works a whole lot better than trying to do one little step here and one little step here and one little step on both sides of the equal sign. You'll just get confused if you do that, is my opinion. So here, I want to do a substitution of u is equal to x plus 1. The reason I'm going to do that is because, let me go and do the derivative, du is equal to 1 times dx, because derivative of this guy is just 1. So the reason I'm going to do that is because when I rewrite the integral, it'll be 1 over u, because x plus 1 is u. And then over here, dx we just found is just going to be equal to du. So this integral I can solve. I know that that's a natural log. I know that that's a natural log. So the integral of 1 over u is natural log of u. Yeah, we have plus constant, but we're going to hang on to that for a little while and put that at the end of our answer. Now, let's go ahead and finish it on out. So we'll say this is the natural log of u, which we found was x plus 1, like this. So that's about as far as we can get. We've done the integral. We have it back in terms of x. Let's go and work on this side. Now here, you might find a substitution there, but again, the same exact thing struck me. You have a numerator with more than one term, and you have a denominator with only one term. So the first thing I think about is trying to break this integral up, you know, as a fraction. So here you would have t squared over t plus 1 over t dt. Common denominator, so I can add the fractions together, and I'm going to get back exactly what I had. Now you'll find that when I start doing this, t squared over t is just going to be t plus 1 over t dt. Now I know how to integrate this, because I know how to integrate this term and I know how to integrate this term. So here we're going to have 1 half t squared, because this is just, you know, a simple polynomial integral there. This guy, integral of 1 over t is the, so I have a plus sign, is the natural log of t. I didn't have to even do any substitution. I'm going to go ahead and write my constant of integration down here on one side. Now I do have a constant over here, but remember what we said, these are basically equal and I'm going to end up solving for x, and so the two constants on both sides are going to combine into your one final constant that you have in the answer. So what I want to do next is just go ahead and say, let's go ahead and do this. How are we going to continue? We'll have natural log of x plus 1 is equal to what we have over here, 1 half t squared plus natural log of t plus a constant. Now the only way to solve for x, because remember, here's a pure function of t, that's cool, but here your x is wrapped up inside of your natural log. The only way to get rid of this is to raise both sides to the natural log, to the e power, basically. Natural log of x plus 1 is equal to, we're going to, and you got to raise the whole thing here. So you'll have 1 half t squared plus natural log of t plus a constant. Right? So you'll do that. Now on the left-hand side, these two guys are going to annihilate each other, and you're going to end up having x plus 1 on the left-hand side. On the right-hand side, this is exactly what we had before. And by the way, in differential equations, it just turns out you're going to have these exponentials popping up all the time. So get used to this little idea of breaking up the exponent, because it's going to happen basically forever. So just to keep it clear, we're going to have on the right-hand side, if I were going to split this up, e to the 1 half t squared, and I'm going to multiply it now, let's say, by e to the natural log of t, this guy, and I'm going to multiply it by e to the c. So all I've done here, you see, this is the same base, so I can add the exponent. So that's all I've done, right? Now what's going to happen, let me go and continue over on the other board. I'll just rewrite what I have here. I'll have x plus 1 is equal to e to the 1 half t squared multiplied by e to the natural log of t multiplied by e to the my little constant of integration that I have, c. So I've just written it down. Again, I've done nothing really. Now here, this is going to annihilate nicely. So what I'll have over here is x plus 1 is equal to, now these are all multiplied together now. So think of it this way. This e to the raised to the power of c is going to be just a constant. So I'm going to put constant is this is it something raised to the, a number, so you're just going to have that constant there. This term, which is multiplied there, e to the natural log, is just going to give you t because they annihilate. And then this guy is e raised to the power of 1/2 t squared, 1/2 t squared. So you're basically almost done. In order to solve for x, you just subtract 1. So you have c times t times e to the 1/2 t squared minus 1. And this is the general solution. So this is c t e to the 1/2 t squared minus 1. So, you know, it looks a little bit more complicated, but it's exactly the same process. You start out with the differential equation here. You think it's separable, so you go ahead and you give it a shot, and you move t over here, and you realize, yes, it is separable. So you begin manipulating the differentials and getting a function of x over here and a function of t over here, and then you integrate both sides. And this side, a substitution is the only thing you can really do here other than looking at a table of integrals. So I do a substitution, it becomes 1 over u, and that's a natural log. I plug back in, and I get natural log of x plus 1. Now on the other side, I didn't really know what to do here, so I split up the fraction just to try to make it simpler, and it turned out it made it very simple. This is a simple integral, and this is a natural log. Go ahead and put your constant of integration. Doesn't matter what side of the equal sign you do it to. At this point, these two guys are equal, so I rewrote the line here with it being equal. The only way to solve for x when it's wrapped up in a natural log like that is to raise the entire equation to the power of e. So I do that on both sides of the equation. I get x plus 1 over here. And on this side, I have each little term raised to the power of e, and I need to write it like this because that's the only way it's going to allow me to really make any progress. So I rewrite this over here, no changes. And then on the next line, I say, well, this constant is just going to come out in front as c. This guy, this is a little bit hard to read here. Let me draw a little line. This guy comes out as a t because they annihilate, and this guy stays exactly the same. And so you just rewrite the whole thing, subtracting 1. And then you get your final guy there. So not crazy complicated, but you know, not a walk in the park either. And so you can imagine that if you had a problem that you had, you know, two integrals like that, but each integral was really hard, like a trigonometric integral from calculus 2 or something crazy like that. Or, you know, when you get into studying more complicated things in, you know, in real world, like three-dimensional problems, then you might have, you know, a three-dimensional vector integral on both sides. I mean, then it gets really, really difficult. I shouldn't say difficult. It just gets to the point where the chances of you making an error are great. So I really, really, really stress that when you're doing these things, you know, work slowly. Don't work too late at night. Try to make sure you get your, you know, every little step correct and check as you go, because, you know, you can make mistakes and you will make mistakes. All right, one more problem. This one's going to be an initial condition problem. So the differential equation is t squared times dx dt is equal to x squared. This is the differential equation. And the initial condition is at time 1, so 1 second after the motion starts or whatever it is, the value of x is 2, whatever x is representing. X could be the position of the ball rolling down a hill. X could be the temperature at 1 second in. I mean, who knows what x is, but that's what our differential equation is. So is it separable? Let's try to move t over here. So dx dt is equal to, we'll call this x squared, and let's just keep it straight here, 1 over t squared. And so you can see when you write it like that, it is separable. Dx dt has a function of x multiplied by a function of t. So we're clear to continue using the technique. And so what we're going to do now, let's move dt over here and let's move x squared over here. So what we'll have is 1 over x squared dx is equal to 1 over t squared dt. So 1 over x squared dx and 1 over t squared dt. So let's go ahead and apply the integral there. So what we'll have is 1 over, now in the inside, 1 over x squared is exactly the same thing as x to the minus 2. I like to write it like that. Whoops, this is dx. And on the right-hand side, you're going to have t to the minus 2 dt. And the integrals are applied to both sides like that. Now, the reason we did that is because these are really simple integrals when you have them written as a polynomial like that. So over here, for this integral, you're going to have 1 over 1 plus the exponent is negative 1, x to the negative 1. And on the right hand side, you're gonna have 1/1 plus the exponent, which is -1, times t to the -1. Now let's go ahead and put our constant of integration down there. Again, you could put it on either side, but we're just gonna have one of them. And this is a one here, just to make it totally clear. So what we're going to have now, this -1 is basically going to totally cancel with this -1, so they're gonna basically disappear. And on the left-hand side, you're gonna have 1/x is equal to 1/t plus a constant. 1/t plus a constant. Now here is where you might scratch your head a little bit, because you need to solve for x as a function of time, but it's wrapped up with this fraction, and over here it doesn't really look very simple. You can't really invert the right-hand side very easily. So what I want to do is change this a little bit. What I want to show you, this is a trick I use from Algebra 1 all the way through calculus. Now here is where you might scratch your head a little bit. You need to solve for x, but it's not really easy to do so because just, you know, 1/x here, and then you have all this stuff here with c wrapped up. So the way I want to proceed is I want to basically multiply this little constant, only this little constant here. Let me put a little parentheses around it just to make it clear. I'm going to multiply it by the quantities t/t. And you might say, what is he doing? Well, let's work with me for a second. 1/x is equal to 1/t. This doesn't change. I'm multiplying by 1 because t/t is just 1. So what I'm going to have is c times t/t. The only reason I did that, notice that this reduces back to just giving you the c that we had before. The only reason I did it is because I want to be able to combine these terms. So I'm going to have 1 + ct/t. And the reason I wanted to combine the terms is so now I can invert both sides. I can divide, you know, 1/both sides, and that's going to give me x is equal to, and I just flip the other side over, t/(1 + ct). 1 + ct. And this is the general solution, by the way. So this is the general solution. This isn't the final answer because we're looking for, we have initial conditions in this problem, but this is the general solution. So we did this stuff. I mean, you could have sort of left it like this, but you really want x by itself. So I just sort of combined terms by basically making a common denominator so that I could flip it over when I did the inversion. Now, let's go back up here to the area where our initial conditions are. So let me write this again. The function that we got for the answer, x/t is equal to t/(1 + ct). Now we know that at time is equal to 1, the value of x is equal to 2. So at that point, we're going to have 2 is equal to, and at time is equal to 1, we're going to put a 1 in there. On the bottom, we're going to have a 1 here. So basically, everywhere where we see a t, we're going to put 1. And then, of course, the function's equal to 2. So we set x/t equal to 2. And so what we're going to have is 2 is equal to 1/(1 + a constant). Let's go ahead and multiply. So we'll have 2 × 1 + a constant is equal to 1, just multiplying this over. And what we'll have here is 2 + 2c is equal to 1. And of course, we'll have, just continuing to solve, 2c is equal to subtracting 2. We'll have -1. C is equal to -1/2. So the constant of integration for that particular case is equal to -1/2. And so you take your general solution, plug in the value that you have for the constant, x as a function of time is equal to t/(1 + actually the constant of integration is negative, so it's going to be -1/2 time. This is a specific solution. Now this really is the answer. I mean, there's nothing wrong with this being the answer, but you know, we like to simplify things a little bit if we can. So what we want to do, let's say, is we'll have t/(1 - 1/2 t). And let's say we multiply this fraction, top and bottom, by 2/2. So we're multiplying by 1, so we're really not changing anything at all. And then x/t at that case would be 2 × t on the top, divided by, multiplying by 2, we're going to get 2 - t on the bottom. So 2t on the top, 2 - t on the bottom, because this is going to go in and cancel with the 1/2. This is the specific solution. This is the specific solution. So this is our differential equation. I mean, the process is exactly the same. The only difference is we get down to the general solution, then we plug in our initial condition. We started with this, and we moved the variables over to get a function of x dx, function of t dt. We integrated both sides. Both of these integrals happen to be very simple. So we went ahead and integrated this guy, and we got everything basically to the point where we had a function of x on one side, a function of t on the other, but we wanted to solve for x. So the easy way to do that is to try to combine these terms. So I kind of did a little bit of a trick here, I guess you could say, multiply the constant by t over t, just so that I could combine it into one little term, so that whenever I inverted this side of the equation, I can invert the other side very easily. This is the answer that you get. This is really, you know, you might think of it as a trick, but it's really an algebra thing. It's not really something you'll see in every problem, but, you know, it was the way that algebraically I could simplify. So we take the general solution, which is, you know, an infinite number of solutions, and we apply our specific initial conditions. We plug in time is equal to 1 right here, and we set that function equal to 2. And then we solve for this constant here. So this is just a little bit of algebra solving for the constant. It was negative 1/2. We take that, we stick it right back in there, negative 1/2. Now, I could have left the answer here. That's fine. But I went ahead and multiplied by 2 over 2 just so I can get rid of the fraction, just because it looks a little bit nicer. So 2t on the top, 2 minus t on the bottom. That's the specific solution for this equation. Now, also notice that this guy only had one constant of integration because it's a first order equation. That's something that you'll see in every problem. If it's a second order or a third order or a fourth order, you're going to have that many constants. That is the topic of separation of variables for ordinary differential equations. It, you know, it's not really much different than what we talked about before. It's basically looking at first order equations of a certain form, breaking them apart, putting them on each side of the equal sign with their differential, and integrating them separately. You integrate them separately, you solve for x, and then that's it, that's the answer. And then if you have initial conditions, you apply them. That's going to be true for any differential equation. Once you get the general solution, if you have initial conditions, you apply them to get the specific solution. I'm Jason. I hope you've learned something from this section. Just practice your problems. Really, it boils down to doing these integrals, and that's going to boil down to your calculus skills. So if you need to use integration by parts, if you need to use a substitution, if you need to use partial fractions, basically, these problems can get more difficult the more complicated the integrals are. And that's basically it. But the general technique is exactly what we've talked about. Split them apart, integrate them, and then solve for x. Learn anything at mathandscience.com.